Hello everyone, Daniel Pizak speaking from Dassault System. I hope you are in a great shape like I am. Thanks God it's Friday, so we'll have plenty of time to take care of us this weekend. But the idea is today, in fact, in this 11th Katia Dual Talk, to talk about design for additive manufacturing, but not for any process of additive manufacturing. As you know, there are many additive manufacturing processes, but I will focus on powder bed fabrication. You know, when a laser is melting metallic powder and layer per layer, the part is built up. So the talk is designed for additive manufacturing, but powder bed fabrication for metal parts. Maybe next time I will talk about some other additive manufacturing processes. So to start with, what is on the screen is a very simple part. It's just a ring, okay? And the ring to be printed, if we decided to print this ring this direction, so the vertical of the screen, you see that to make it happen, to be able to produce it, remember it's layer per layer, you have to, as a metal, as a powder, and the fusion of the powder as making some special phenomena, you have to grab the part when it is built layer per layer. And in order for the process to be run properly, you have to add what we call supports, okay? And those supports, obviously, once the part is built up, you will grab the build tray, you will remove the powder, and you will get this in real life, and then you will have to remove the support. So remember, it's metal support, it can be titanium. So we will probably use a wire cutting or saw, electrical saw, maybe CNC machining to remove it then. So it's quite not a nice process. And the finishing of this part is quite costly, okay? So the idea is to take into account, in fact, this particular constraint, which is the biggest constraint in powder bed fabrication. There are some others that we will talk about, but to take into account this, how to minimize this support when you are manufacturing the part. Okay, let's go. So here I am in the Delmia powder bed fabrication app. It's a dedicated app from the 3D Experience platform to be able to program the additive layer manufacturing part of such a part. But let's start by something which is, let's say, the most obvious. In CUTIA, we have something called structural driven generative design, which has integrated as a topology optimization target a manufacturing constraint specialized for additive manufacturing powder bed fabrication. So let's have a look. Let's see, I have this legacy part, maybe a CUTIA V5 part, maybe something I receive from my customer as a step format. So I just import the data in 3D Experience CUTIA. And I will probably, because it's a redesign of the part, which has to be done in additive manufacturing, I will give some freedom to the topology optimization engine of CUTIA to do the job. So this is the freedom I gave. I kept the mechanical interfaces holes because I don't want to remove those holes. So I make a safety zone around the holes, maybe 20 millimeters. This is the CUTIA functional generative design app, and you can see that CUTIA is automatically finding in the design space that I'm starting with those holes and those protected area. It's a finite element analysis based topology optimization tool. It's based on Abacus for the solver and Tosca for the optimization. And then the very first thing that I have to do as a designer is to prepare the specification of the part. So the part will be fixed to some other part with some balls, stuff like that. It will be also linked with some other parts with those drillings. And here I have first force at the center of gravity of those four holes of a given magnitude and a given direction. Let's design another force, which will be put in a different load cases. So I have two forces. I will put those two forces in two separate load cases. You can have as many load cases you want in CUTIA, and combine those load case with also boundary conditions that we'll define later on. So this is my first step, define the load cases. Then I will define the boundary condition. Here, this part is fixed to the other part with a bolt, what we call a virtual bolt. I just have to describe the shear stiffness and the axial stiffness, okay? And of course, the dimension of the bolt. Katia is now smart enough to find out that there are some holes with the same diameter, and he will propose to me to replicate the bolt definition to the other holes. Now, very important, I have to define my target. My target is, I could have, for example, target of optimizing the eigenfrequency, minimizing the mass, but here I will use the most used target for topology optimization, which is maximize stiffness and reduce the volume of this so-called design space, maybe by 85%. This is what I'm doing right now. Okay, this is my target. I know the material. I know the design space. I know the load case. I know the boundary condition. Let's add some constraints. For the very first stuff, I will first add a constraints on symmetry of the shape. But also, you will see, this is my symmetry plan, okay? So even if the boundary condition and the load case are not symmetrical, I would like to get an output, a geometry, which will be symmetrical. Here we go, I select my plane, this guy, I'm fine. And now I talk to my people in the shop floor. They told me, Daniel, we will use this particular additive manufacturing machine. I recommend you to use this vertical of the screen as a printing direction. And my machine, the maximum angle where you should have support is between 90 degrees and 45 degrees. So everything between 45 degrees and zero will need support, like I showed you on the ring, okay? So this is my angle, my shape control. Here we go. This is the direction, this axe in pink, and this is the angle for the supporting area. So now what Katia will try to do, he will try to optimize the weight of this part, so remove as much material as possible, keep the part stiff enough, but also try to minimize the area which are between 0 and 45 degrees versus the vertical of the screen. Okay, that's the goal. I run the computation of the concept shape. This is the result. You see, it's very strange result. Very, very good to be printed because, you know, additive manufacturing, you can easily print very, very complex parts. So looks good to me. I can automatically, with the PTIA, you can compute a preliminary design, a concept, so not a preliminary, I would say a concept design. This is an automatic reconstruction of the mesh by what we call subdivision surface in CATIA. So one who are familiar with CATIA and familiar with a workbench called Imagine and Shape are probably know what I'm talking about. So it's a C2 curvature continuous surface. So here it's an exact solid, it's no longer a mesh. You can do fillet, for example, to smooth those edges. You can do Boolean operation, you can make a drawing, you can mill it, if it's stupid because I want to make an additive manufacturing. So it's really a CAD model, you can step out and send to another CAD system, for example. Here, what I will do as another step, very important, validate. In one click, all the boundary condition loads, everything is kept. I just have to remesh the part, but it is done automatically because as you can see, the mesh is different for the design space and the final part. And I can check in a couple of seconds that my part is okay. Now, the part is okay, but I would like to smooth it a little bit because the people do not trust, in fact, shapes which are not nice. Okay, you trust what is nice, okay? So let's make it nice. So I just cut half of the part and we will work on half of the part. And then I use dedicated tool in CATIA to smooth this solid. So I just drop lines on my tubes. I will create a smoother surface or smoother solid. And then I will blend all those tubes together to make the final shape, okay? It's very simple, it's not accelerated. It's really the time it took to smooth this complex solid by an even smoother surface. And then once the job is done, I just have in the spectre of CATIA to replace the automatically reconstructed surface by this new guy and update my model. And then I get the final job. It's still in preliminary design, okay? Because now I will have to probably make the fillet on all those edges, okay? But looks good, looks much better. Even if the first one was strong, okay? So I validate, looks nice to me. And now I will just If I want, I can modify, thanks to the subdivision surfaces technology that we are using, I can modify the shape. That's one way of doing things. I can do some other things, and I am in CATIA, so I can take benefit of the solid modeling capability of CATIA. I can take benefit of the surface modeling of CATIA, generative shape design, one of the jewels of CATIA, to finish my job. And looks now that I am at the detailed design stage, and looks good. But let's check. So validation does not cost anything, so why don't we do it? And now inside CATIA, I have also a very nice tool for additive manufacturing, which is the overhang analysis capability. You can see here the threshold or angle and the direction. Okay, so let's define the direction of the printing. This is it. And what you see in yellow are, in fact, the part which still needs support. So CATIA was not able in this particular case to have a self-supported result, but it's very, very minor area. And then it's just the experience of the designer that will, for example, change those vertical members by cross members to have smaller area and therefore less support. But it's just a design experience, okay? Looks nice. Of course, we change the design. We will have to validate the design. Here we go. Validation is perfect. I can print it, okay? So you saw here that we can easily design a part specially for additive manufacturing, taken into account all those constraints coming from the supporting process in the additive manufacturing powder bed fabrication process. Okay, one thing very important. Now let's move to another aspect. I have my part. I go to now to the Delnia powder bed fabrication app, which is where I will program my additive manufacturing machine. I have my build tray. I knew the direction of the printing because it's my decision and I optimize the part for that. This is it. But maybe there are some particular rules that have been embedded by the expert of additive manufacturing just down in the shop floor. And they told me, we already put our know-how, we define rules depending on the material. You can see here, we can have aluminum or titanium or Inconel or stainless steel, and all those materials might have different rules for the supporting, which is the case, but all those rules can be embedded into CATIA and Delnia. And I will ask, I'm not an expert of additive manufacturing, but I just have to go there, select the rules which have been predefined, run the computation of the supporting. And you can see there are still support here, okay? Just in the middle of the part. So maybe I can, and it's not easy to remove. So maybe what, as a designer, I take the decision of changing that, okay? I am responsible of the part. And I accept to do this modification. It does not change the engineering specification. So I take the part, I modify the part, I make a little bit sharper the angle of this particular pocket. I go back to the Delnia powder bed fabrication. I update the computation of the supporting, and hopefully I will be lucky. Yes, I am lucky. Those undesirable support has been removed. Remember, additive manufacturing is great. You can do many, many things, very complex shapes, such as the one I showed you, light, very lighter part, but also you can combine multiple parts and reduce the number of parts for a given product and maybe reduce drastically the number of parts. Let's have a look on this particular front wheel bracket of this bike. So in this particular case, I will do exactly the same thing, but I put together two parts, okay? So I create a design space around the two parts. This is it. And I don't want to enter into the detail because it's exactly the same steps. And this is the result. So instead of having two parts that have to be assembled together, I have just one part that I will additive manufacture. Looks good. You can check that everything fine. I just validate my shape. It's very important to validate to see if the part is okay. This is the von Mises stresses. You can see how it is deformed. Of course, it is exaggerated. There are some warping and shrinking. This is a part, the new part. And what you can see is that we replace the actual legacy bracket by the new one, and we reduce from four components to one component. We are not buying anymore those screws. we have not to assemble those two guys together, and we reduce the weight. It's very important. Additive manufacturing bring a lot, maybe only for that. Let's move forward. Now, as maybe you don't know, but in additive manufacturing, you cannot do everything. You cannot do very small ribs. You cannot do very small holes. You cannot do very small thickness. And not a problem. As a designer, I am in CATIA. I can use the knowledge work capability of CATIA. In 3D experience, it's called CATIA Know-How Reuse. My expert of this particular machine put already automatically all the rules for this machine. Maybe I have multiple machines I can use. I have maybe a different set of rules, but it's not a problem. I just select from my database, the rule I would like to use. And in this particular case, it's very simple. I just go to the database, select my rule. Here we go. And then I will run the check, and you can see that I have an issue. It's not completely green, it's half green, half red, and there is some issue here with a warning. So just expand the spec tree and check what is problem. So I have two pads which have a good height, but two pads where the height is too big, too high. This is very simply done in KnowledgeWare of CATIA. So now as a designer, at any stage of my design, I can run this check and change the eye to something which is acceptable. Do that for the two pads which have been identified as failure. And then rerun the check to see that everything's fine. Okay, now I know that this part, as I designed this part, is for compliant to the rules for this particular additive manufacturing machine. And maybe it's also depending on the material. If it's in polymer, you have maybe less or more freedom than it's if it's in metal. Another capability of CATIA, which is very nice in functional generative design, is when you display this area which are needing of support, this can be a permanent display. So as long as you are designing, this color-coded display is permanent. Let's have a look on this very small part. So I designed this guy. I use now the generative overhang analysis. Okay. I select my part, and automatically you see where the problem, okay? Because it took the default direction, the axis of the compass. Of course, I can change this direction. Remember, this direction is the printing direction. I can type in whatever threshold angle, 45, 50. Usually it's between sometimes 10 degrees for some machine, up to 45. I can select another direction, a line. I see the display. I can, why not change the direction of the position of the first point to change the direction. So it's fully associative. I can even do something more. I can also visualize or display and filter out small areas, because if you have a very, very small area, you don't care. You will not make any support. But if the area is big, yes, you probably need support. So you can display that. Those minimum areas can be filtered out. Here I display, you see in blue, you will see in blue, here you go. Those are smaller than 30 millimeter. Of course, this one is not, it's bigger, okay? And now if I move, changing my design, maybe for example, using subdivision surface or adding a fillet or cut by a plane or whatever, anything, at any time, I can, of course, see real time the effect of my design. So I still have a supporting area, and I can also check if it's under a given size, or if it's acceptable or not. This is not real time, this small areas, because it's more computing, it needs more computing time, so it's why it's not real time. The rest is much faster, so it's always permanent, okay? This is a very nice tool for designers, if you design for additive. Now, I showed you how you can design for additive, okay, as an engineering guy. Now I am no longer an engineering guy. I am the guy in charge of printing this part. So I will make a copy paste with result as result with link of the part from my engineering office. And now I am the shop floor guy. I will modify the part to adapt the shape to be 3D printed. The engineering part is frozen. I cannot touch it, but I need to make it printable. So I will modify it. Here, very simple modification. I will never be able in 3D printing with my machine to have the exact dimension of those holes. I will just make them smaller because those holes will be drilled later on at the right dimension. Okay. Same for this guy. I will need to add another thickness here, all over, because I will just then make a surfacing with my CNC machine to get the right thickness and, of course, the flatness of the part. That's the first very simple modification. Now, I'm smart. I know that if I have this type of shape instead of a circle, I will not have any support because this angle is above 45 degrees. So how can I do to quickly convert the holes into such a shape? Very simply, by using, again, power copies, the knowledge ware of Katia. I can either replace the square, the cylinder by the diamond, or make this type of water drop, okay, shape, which is also, if the printing direction is this guy, will not need at all, supporting. So let's do a power copy. I make my power copy, and now, okay, that's it. I will just instantiate my power copy on my new part, so maybe a part which has been topology optimized, I recover my power copy from my database, select the holes I would like to transform, and very easily I can transform all those guys we need support into a shape which is not needing support, and then of course I will have to mill on my CNC machine the circle at the right dimension. But the printing will be faster and I will consume less material. Now, a very, very typical topic in when you are designing a CAD part, if this is threaded, you just say it's threaded, but you don't design the thread. But if you want to print the thread, you have to design it in 3D. Okay, so let's do exactly the same. I use a power copy. I just select the area to be threaded and I select the pitch, the depth, and I have now a threaded hole, real threaded hole, and when it will be printed, obviously, I will get the exact shape I need. Very simple stuff, but KnowledgeWare is very, very powerful for that in CATIA. Of course, I will do that on both sides. Another example, I am my part. I said I don't want to topology optimize because I just want to have this part and I would like to gain weight, so I will fill the inside of the part with a lattice structure. And as you know, only additive manufacturing today can produce lattice part. But you have to check that, okay? So you have to check that the part that you lattice, this is your decision as a designer. You see here very easily with CATIA, you can create this lattice, but very easily, you can also validate by finite element analysis that the part is strong enough. Here, it's not a topology optimized part, so there was no specification. I just want to validate my design. Good news, the lattice information is inside the CATIA lattice feature, and the Simulia application can automatically read this lattice information, converted this lattice information into a beam 1D element, glue those beam 1D elements to the outer tetrahedral element of the thickness, combine together and make a validation very easily. If there is an issue, in a couple of seconds, I can go back to CATIA, change either the lattice parameter or change the thickness or whatever, make a right engineering change. I'm almost finished. And let's finish by another nice capability. It's not really finished, but in Delinear Power Double Fabrication tool, we have something called distortion checker. So you have a part, for example, the part I just designed with my lattice. I can simulate in a second, or almost in a second, let's say a couple of minutes. I'm not a stress analyst. I'm not a stress analyst specialist. I am a regular guy, designer guy. So I will just go to this distortion checker capability. Automatically, it will compute a quick, not dirty, but a quick estimation of the distortion of the part and the displacement of the part and the actual stress on the part. And again, of course, I have some parameter to change the density and the size of the elements, which are voxel mesh, and I can easily, for example, here, check the displacement, the deformation, which are occurring on the part. So as a designer, I can use a tool which is easy for me to use and check that, for example, in this particular case, there is an issue here. You can see that there are some issues here. The part is not strong enough. So we probably have to change this thickness on this particular part. Okay. Very easy to do. Couple of click and you get this checking of this distortion occurring during 3D printing. And to finish, last time, I think it was in the CATIA Jewel Talk number 7, just before Christmas, I talked about the new capability of CATIA in Lattice. I just show you also quickly the Lattice capability in CATIA. But now let's see how we can go even further. Let's do an optimization of the Lattice structure here on this bike crank. In fact, the parameters of the lattice, which are the orientation of the pattern, the size of the pattern, the diameter of the pattern, the type of pattern, are parameters. And those parameters can be optimized. And I can go in Simulia Parametric Design Study, which is a physics app on the 3D Experience platform. Run this design exploration. You can see here all the various unit size and the height. And I can, just by clicking on the various solution, display the various solution. Maybe on those simulation, select some of them that I will compute to validate and select the most ideal solution. So here you see the computation of the, let's say maybe half of the solution, and then I zoom in a particular area and I will just select 2, 3, 4, 5 of them and find out which are the best one for my design regarding the KPI I put in place, which is maybe the mass, maybe the maximum displacement, maybe the maximum von Mises stress. Here we go. You see, it's very simple. And once I select my design, I know now the parameters, I can update my lattice structure by the optimal parameters for this lattice. And then I will convert this lattice feature into a representation made of triangulation, add the fillets between the bars, add the fillet between the bars and the outer shell, and make a very, very nice looking and nice for printing and nice for stiffness lattice, and use, of course, a 3D additive manufacturing machine, powder bed, or laser sintering to print it. Many, many thanks for attending this session. It's always a pleasure to be with you, you know. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you learned some stuff. As you know, CATIA is full of jewels, and there are still other jewels I would like to discuss with you next time. Don't hesitate to go to the go.3ds.com/CATIA. It's a CATIA user community. You just have to give your email address. It's free of charge, and you can get much, much more information. You can replay all those CATIA jewel talks, and you can ask questions to myself, to my team, and it will be my pleasure to answer. Thanks a lot for attending. Have a nice weekend and talk to you soon. Bye bye.
I think we have question for you, Daniel.
Yep. How can I link CATIA to MATLAB? In fact, there is a link. We can integrate MATLAB information directly in CATIA Modelica. So yes, you can combine those. Okay, Modelica Daimola is based on Modelica. Daimola is our tool, which is, let's say, comparable to MATLAB in some spectrum. And the answer is yes, you can use that. We can also use FMI. You know, it's a functional modeling interface. And you can pass from MATLAB to CATIA through this FMI standard format. Okay, on generative design, most of the operations are automatic. The conversion of the mesh, which are representing the isosurface between the plane and the void elements, for the topology optimization. This is automatically done by CUTIA. Then what is not automatically done by CUTIA is to create those smoothing by dropping the lines. This is not automatically, but it's very, very fast, to be honest. And I think I get an answer to all those questions. If you have any other question on your side? No? Okay, so I think we can conclude the session. And come next time to attend the 12th one, you will also be hopefully surprised. Bye-bye.